Hi everyone, I'm Prateek, and in this video we're going to be looking at the anatomy of panoramic films, or OPTs, DPTs, or OPGs. If you haven't done so already, please make sure to check out my book, Single Best Answer Questions for Dentistry. For anyone sitting dental examinations, this is a key revision resource with over 280 single best answer questions. All the links are in the description. OPTs can be quite difficult to interpret if you're not used to looking at them, but hopefully in this video I'll go through some of the key anatomical landmarks on OPTs to help you become more confident with interpreting them. So first, let's look at the mandible. Here we can see the mandibular condyle. So this will be seen as a rounded, radio-opaque area located within the glenoid fossa towards the lateral aspects of the panoramic film. The glenoid fossa, remember, is that concave area that we have in the zygomatic process of the temporal bone, and it forms part of the temporomandibular joint. The coronoid process can be seen more medial to the condyle as a radio-opaque, triangular area, typically overlying the maxillary tuberosity and maybe some of the sinus. If we're looking at the mandibular condyle and the glenoid fossa, just in front of this, you can see the articular eminence. And remember how, again, this is a key component of the temporomandibular joint. If we follow down for the mandibular condyle and the coronoid process, we follow onto the ramus of the mandible. This then joins onto the body of the mandible, and the location that these two come together is the angle of the mandible. Within this area, we'll be able to see a radial lucent canal that has two parallel radio-opaque lines, and this is the inferior alveolar canal, where we have the inferior alveolar nerve travelling through. This radial lucent band will travel from the middle of the ramus through the body of the mandible, and then will ultimately reach a radial lucent round or ovoid area, roughly around the apex of the lower 4 and 5 region. And this is where we have the mental foramen, where the mental nerve will exit the mandible. We also have the lower border of the mandible, which is a thick, radio-opaque band that we can see here. Next, let's look at the maxilla. So we have the maxillary sinus either side, and this is seen as a large radiolucent area above the maxillary dentition. Surrounding this radiolucent area, we have the walls or the borders of the maxillary sinuses, and these are seen as thin radio-opaque lines. Often, these lines can come very close to the maxillary teeth, hence the reason that we warn patients of the risk of oroantral communication. On an OPT, if we think of how the imaging is done, the machine rotates around the patient, and therefore you have to consider the panoramic film as a patient's face flattened out. So, when we're looking at the maxillary sinus walls on a panoramic film, we are seeing the posterior wall and we're seeing the floor of the maxillary sinus. These are key areas to look at if we're considering identifying any sinister pathology. If these lines are missing, it's of significant concern. We can then also see the zygomatic process of the maxilla, or the malar buttress, and this usually comes down as a U, V, or J-shaped radio-opaque area, usually around the first or second maxillary molars. And this is why sometimes it can be difficult to take these teeth out, because the bone is usually quite dense in this region. If we then look at the nasal cavity, the borders of the nasal cavity can be seen as radio-opaque lines medial to the maxillary sinus. We can also see a soft tissue within the nasal cavity. This includes the nasal septum, which is a radio-opaque area at the centre of the panoramic film, as well as potentially the inferior nasal turbinate, which is seen as a round or a curved radio-opaque mass within the nasal cavity. You can see the floor of the nasal cavity as well, or the hard palate, and this will be present as a thin radio-opaque line, and it may again be superimposed over other structures such as the maxillary sinus or the maxillary teeth. If we then move to other structures of the midface, we can often see the orbital rim, which is a thick semicircular radio-opaque line superior to the maxillary sinuses. Additionally, lateral to the maxillary sinuses, we can often see the pterygomaxillary fissure, which is an inverse teardrop shape of radiolucency surrounded by a very thin radio-opaque line. Next, we may also see the zygomatic bone. So we've already spoken about the zygomatic process of the maxilla. So if we look at this area and then we follow it backwards, we can see the zygomatic bone and going onto the zygomatic arch. So you have this radio-opaque area distal to the zygomatic process. And with the path that it's taking, it will usually be superimposed over the maxillary tuberosity and the pterygomaxillary fissure. Other little bits of anatomy that you may notice on an OPT. You may see the external auditory meatus as a round or ovoid radiolucent area lateral to the glenoid fossa or the condyles of the mandible. You may also see the soft tissue of the earlobe, and this is again seen as a radio-opaque area roughly superimposed or around the areas of the ramus of the mandible. The cervical spine is also seen on a panoramic film. You will typically have superimposition of the cervical spine through the center of the film, and this can often make interpreting anterior anatomy quite difficult. But also, depending on the positioning of the patient, you may also see the cervical spine on the lateral aspects of the panoramic film. Additionally, adjacent to the cervical spine, if it is present laterally, you may see the styloid process. The styloid process may be insignificant in most patients. However, in some patients, an elongated styloid process can be an indication of conditions such as Eagle syndrome. Next, if we look inferior or just along the lower border of the mandible, we may see the hyoid bone as another radio-opaque area. This can be superimposed over the mandible. So we've got the soft palate as well. The soft palate can be seen as a radio-opaque mass that is found next to the hard palate. However, it is less radio-dense compared to surrounding bony structures because there is no bone present within the soft palate. We can also consider the air spaces. So we have the nasopharynx, which is found as a radiolucent area coming off from the nasal cavity. Below this, we have the oropharynx, which is a radiolucent area that is attached to the airspace in the mouth. And then below this, we have the hypopharynx. From the oropharynx, if we follow this into the mouth, in some patients who haven't put their tongue to the roof of the mouth during the panoramic film, we may see an obvious shadowing or darkening within the oral cavity that is indicative of the airspace that is present there. So hopefully, this has covered most of the important anatomy in an OPT, and now you'll feel more confident interpreting this form of imaging. My recommendation in this video is the BrushDJ app, which is an app created by dentist Ben Underwood in order to help patients with their oral hygiene. If you did find this video useful, please make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Until the next video, take care.